Welcome back, my friend. So here we are, dressed as a James Bond supervillain, because I was just watching some Bill Nye, and you can't not dress up whilst you watch Bill Nye. The guy's got some serious swag. Right, that's the old term, isn't it? I meant to say grip these days, nowadays. I might put the Bill Nye video up tomorrow, though, and this one tonight. And I was already wearing this, so why not? You know, let's do something different. It's kind of funny. I enjoy being an idiot. So before we get into the video, two things. One, check out KelVPN. The alpha is coming out hopefully next week, so go sign up if you want to hear about that. Second thing, the Daily Dance newsletter is almost ready. Everything is kind of ready, so I'm going to start that within the next couple days, I think. So you should go sign up in the description. The Daily newsletter breaking down the latest science and business in a very quick fashion. Take you like 2 minutes to read. It's completely free. If you already signed up for KelVPN, don't need to. I'll just chuck you on the email list. Hopefully that's okay with you guys. You can unsubscribe if you don't want to receive it. 60 frames per second. Here we come.
What is the largest star in the universe? And why is it that large? And what are stars anyway? Things that would like to be stars. We begin our journey with Earth, not to learn anything, just to get a vague sense of scale. The smallest things that have some star-like properties are large gas giants or sub-brown dwarfs, like Jupiter, the most massive planet in the solar system, 11 times larger and 317 times more massive than Earth, and more or less made of the same stuff as our Sun, just much, much less of it. The transition towards stars begins with brown dwarfs, failed stars that are a huge disappointment to their mums. They have between 30...
He just said failed stars are a disappointment to their mothers. Maybe I'm a brown dwarf. He always wanted me to be a sports star.
...and 90 times the mass of Jupiter. So even if we took 90 Jupiters and threw them at each other, although fun to watch, it wouldn't be enough to create a star. Interestingly, adding lots of mass to a brown dwarf doesn't make it much bigger, just its insides denser. This increases the pressure in the core enough to make certain nuclear fusion reactions happen slowly and the object glow a little. So brown dwarfs are a sort of glowy gas giant that don't fit into any category very well. But we want to talk about stars, not failed wannabe stars, so let's move on.
I love how he's just roasting brown dwarfs at the start of this video. So brown dwarfs form alongside stars in clusters, so there's a lot of studies that suggest there's a huge number of brown dwarfs out there. The minimum number in the Milky Way is something like 25 billion to 100 billion. But there's probably a lot more than that, because there's many more brown dwarfs in the galaxy that are just too small to be detected with our telescopes currently. Like, hopefully JWST can help figure this out, but yeah.
Main sequence stars. Once large gas balls pass a certain mass threshold, their cores become hot and dense enough to ignite. Hydrogen is fused to helium in their cores, releasing tremendous amounts of energy. Stars that do that are called main sequence stars. The more massive a main sequence star is, the hotter and brighter it burns, and the shorter its life is. Once the hydrogen burning phase is over, stars grow up to hundreds of thousands of times their original size. But these giant phases only last for a fraction of their lifespan. So we'll be comparing stars at drastically different stages in their lives. This doesn't make them less impressive, but maybe it's good to keep in mind that we'll be comparing babies to adults. Now back to the beginning. The smallest real stars are red dwarfs, about 100 times the mass of Jupiter, barely massive enough to fuse hydrogen to helium. Because they are not very massive, they are small, not very hot, and shine pretty dimly. They are the only stars in the main sequence that don't grow once they die, but sort of fizzle out. Red dwarfs are by...
Life might have a hard time surviving around a red dwarf, and maybe there was no life found on the planets around a red dwarf. Very temperamental, these small stars. And they have a lot of magnetic activity, which results in a lot of flares, super flares, way more than our star, right? And so we thought this would make, you know, for a very bad situation if life is on a planet that has to be closer because they're not as hot, right? So the planet has to be closer to sustain liquid water and life as we know it. But recently we figured out that unlike our star, red dwarfs actually seem to flare way more at their poles, you know, the top and bottom of the star, whereas our star likes to flare around the equator. So we now think life, that, you know, planets and life around red dwarfs could actually be, you know, a good possibility. And that TRAPPIST-1, which is a famous red dwarf system, star system, and a bunch of planets around this TRAPPIST-1 star, there could be life. And that's like really close to us. So who knows, one day we might be able to bunny hop to, you know, the star system. And it just gets me going thinking about that. I just want to write a sci-fi story about it. It's such, yeah, I'm so upset that, you know, I won't be around to see that one day, but at least some people will be, hopefully. And I'm sure it's going to be beautiful. Anyway, let's keep going.
Far the most abundant type in the universe. Because they burn their fuel very slowly, it lasts them up to 10 trillion years, 1,000 times the current age of the universe. For example, one of the closest stars to Earth is a red dwarf star, Barnard Star. But it
So what color do you think a red dwarf actually is? So you might be confused to hear that red dwarfs, also called M dwarfs, are not actually red. Like, what color would they appear? Well, of course, the spectrum is weighted towards the red wavelengths, but it has more to do with the physiology of the eye rather than astrophysics, right? So it's actually, they'd actually appear like orangish.
To be seen without a telescope. We made a whole video on red dwarfs if you want to learn more. The next stage are stars like our sun. To say the sun dominates the solar system is not doing it justice, since it makes up 99.86% of all its mass. It burns far hotter and brighter than red dwarfs, which reduces its lifetime to about 10 billion years. The Sun is 7 times more massive than Barnard Star, but that makes it nearly 300 times brighter with twice its surface temperature. Let's go bigger. Small changes in mass produce enormous changes in a main sequence star's brightness. The brightest star in the night sky, Sirius, is 2 solar masses with a radius 1.7 times that of the Sun, but its surface is nearly 10,000 degrees Celsius, making it shine 25 times brighter. Burning that hot reduces its total lifespan by 4 times to 2.5 billion years. Stars close to 10 times the mass of our Sun have surface temperatures near 25,000 degrees Celsius. Beta Centauri contains 2 of these massive stars, each shining with about 20,000 times the power of the Sun. That's a lot of power coming from something only 13 times larger, but they'll only burn for about 20 million years. Entire generations of these blue stars die in the time it takes the Sun to orbit the galaxy once. So is this the formula? The more massive, the larger the star.
It's about 225 million years, by the way, for one.
The massive star that we know is R136A1. It has 315 solar masses and is nearly 9 million times brighter than the Sun. And yet, despite its tremendous mass and power, it's barely 30...
This theme song they've got playing in the background reminding me of the Armageddon theme.
...times the size of the Sun. The star is so extreme and barely held together by gravity that it loses 321,000 billion tons of material through its stellar wind every single second. Stars of this sort are extremely rare because they break the rules of star formation a tiny bit. When supermassive stars are born, they burn extremely hot and bright, and this blows away any extra gas that could make them more massive. So the mass limit for such a star is around 150 times the Sun. Stars like R136A1 are probably formed through the merger of several high-mass stars in dense star-forming regions and burn their core hydrogen in only a few million years.
Boy.
So this means they are rare and short-lived. From here, the trick to going bigger isn't adding more mass. To make the biggest stars, we have to kill them. Red giants. When main sequence stars begin to exhaust the hydrogen in their core, it contracts, making it hotter and denser. This leads to hotter and faster fusion, which pushes back against gravity and makes the outer layers swell in a giant phase. And these stars become truly giant indeed. For example, Gakrux.
Imagine being called something as badass as Dacrux, only to be beat by something called Steve. Yeah, disappointing.
Only 30% more massive than the Sun, it has swollen to about 84 times its radius. Still, when the Sun enters the last stage of its life, it will swell and become even bigger, 200 times its current radius. In this final phase of its life, it will swallow the inner planets. And if you think that's impressive, let's finally introduce the largest stars in the universe, hypergiants. Hypergiants are the giant phase of the most massive stars in the universe. They have an enormous surface area that can radiate an insane amount of light. Being so large, they're basically blowing themselves apart, as gravity at the surface is too weak to hold on to the hot mass, which is lifted away in powerful stellar winds. Pistol star is 25 solar masses, but 300 times the radius of the Sun, a blue hypergiant aptly named for its energetic blue starlight. It's hard to say exactly how long Pistol Star will live, but probably just a few million years. Even larger than the blue hypergiants are the yellow hypergiants. The most well-studied is Rho Cassiopeia, a star so bright it can be seen with the naked eye, although it's thousands of light-years from Earth. At 40 solar masses, this star is around 500 times the radius of the Sun and 500,000 times brighter. If the Earth were as close to Rho Cassiopeia as it is to the Sun, it'd be inside it and you would be very dead. Yellow hypergiants are very rare though, only 15 are known. This means they're likely just a short-lived intermediate state, as a star grows or shrinks between other phases of hypergiantness. With red hypergiants, we reach the largest stars known to us, probably the largest stars even possible. So, who's the winner of this insane contest? Well, the truth is, we don't know. Red hypergiants are extremely bright and far away, which means that even tiny uncertainties in our measurements can give us a huge margin of error for their size. Worse still, red hypergiants are solar system-sized behemoths that are blowing themselves apart, which makes them harder to measure. As we do more science and our instruments improve, whatever the largest star is will change. The star that is currently thought to be among the largest we've found is Stevenson 218. It was probably born as a main sequence star a few tens of times the mass of the Sun and has
just named that after himself.
Likely lost about half its mass by now.
Whenever you're feeling stressed, just remember that the largest star in the universe is named Steve, and even he has trouble keeping himself together. Gotta love that one of the biggest objects we've observed in the universe is called Steve.
While typical red hypergiants are 1,500 times the size of the Sun, the largest rough estimate places Stevenson 218 at 2,150 solar radii and shining with almost 500,000 times the power of the Sun. By comparison, the Sun seems like a grain of dust. Our brains don't really have a way of grasping this kind of scale. Even at light speed, it would take you 8.7 hours to travel around it once. The fastest plane on Earth would take around 500 years.
Oh my God.
Dropped on the Sun, it would fill Saturn's orbit. As it evolves, it will probably shed even more mass and shrink down into another hotter hypergiant phase, accumulate heavy elements in its core, before finally exploding in a core collapse supernova, giving its gas back to the galaxy. This gas will then go on to form another generation of stars of all sizes, starting the cycle of birth and death again to light up our universe. Let's make this journey again, but this time without the talking. The universe is big. There are many large things in it.
Wow, what a theme. All right, let's talk about some theoretical types of stars, which actually might be able to challenge big old Steve for a largest star in the universe. But just please keep in mind, completely theoretical, they probably don't even exist, right? So let's start with dark matter stars. So these things would have existed before the first normal stars were born, right? But if they're real, they could exist today. So you might be confused by the name, because these stereo stars would actually mostly be made of normal matter, which, like hydrogen and helium, like our sun, right? But these dark stars would also have significant amounts of this stuff called neutralino dark matter. So in the same way that atoms make up normal matter, these neutralinos are a hypothetical type of particle, which some physicists think might make up dark matter. And some supersymmetry theory suggests these neutralinos might even be WIMPs, which are weakly interacting massive particles, a common dark matter candidate, right? If these theories are correct, these neutralino particles actually serve as their own antimatter, which means if they ever touch each other, they'll completely annihilate, which would generate a lot of energy and heat, right? And the raw power of this annihilation would actually allow dark matter stars to continue, like, going for billions of years without ever needing to collapse to undergo nuclear fusion, which is like a prerequisite for normal stars, right? So this means these things could be huge, like growing to tens or maybe even like thousands of astronomical units in diameter, which is the average Earth-Sun distance. So even though they're this big, their lack of fusion, relatively low temperature, would probably make these things like truly dark, maybe even invisible to our eye. So, but before you get too excited about stars made of dark matter, you should probably know that experiments in particle colliders haven't even been able to turn up any convincing evidence of neutralinos. All right, let's talk about these quasi-stars to wrap up. So Steve, you know, had the largest star we've ever seen, right? Had a radii of like 2,150 times out of our sun. These quasi-stars, you're talking like 7,000 times larger than the sun. And the diameter of them can be like well into the billions. That's like the largest are thought to be like 6 billion miles of like hot, you know, fuming gas and energy. But the main difference between normal stars and these quasi-stars isn't actually in size. It's in the process at their cores. So an average star will use fusion as its energy source, as I'm sure you know, right? But these quasi-stars, they take a more extreme route. They actually have black holes at their core. And these things would be feeding on incoming matter, and this would give off radiation that would power the star, right? And so these things would grow rapidly and balloon to like thousands of times the mass of the sun. So the idea is that eventually they become supermassive black holes with billions of solar masses, you know, at the center of most galaxies in the universe. Supermassive black holes are like kind of a mystery. They're everywhere. And there's ultramassive black holes as well, like the really big ones. We can't really explain how they got so big so quickly. So this quasi-star route is kind of like a theoretical solution, but we really don't know. I think we'll wrap it up there, guys. Hope you enjoyed watching. Just remember those stars that we just talked about, they're theoretical, and I'll catch you next time.